Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We are talking about when evidences collide with each other, and we have moved on to the third category, which is when a general evidence, am, collides with a khas, a specific evidence. So what do we do in this case? We have answered this question before. We make a takhsis. So the specific evidence makes an exception to the general evidence. An example of this is something which we have mentioned before, the hadith in which the Prophet said, فِيمَا سَاقَتِ السَّمَاءَ الْعُشَرْ, in what the sky waters you pay a tenth in zakah. And so this is general for all types of crops and for all amounts of crops, whether they be a little amount or a large amount. But we have a hadith which is khas, in which the Prophet said, لَيْسَ فِيمَا دُونَ خَمْسَةِ أَوْسُقٍ صَدَقَةٍ, in what is less than 5 awsuq, there is no sadaqah, meaning zakah. And 5 awsuq is 300 sa', which is 900 kilograms. So this latter hadith is specifying that there is no sadaqah if your crops are less than 5 awsuq. And it's also specifying the type of crops on which zakah is given. They are the types of crops which are measured using the awsuq, which means they are measured using the sa' and the mud. So it does not include all types of fruits, and it does not include vegetables. So the way to make the reconciliation is that you make a takhsis, which means you take out certain items of the generality from the generality. When it comes to takhsis, one point should be noted, and this is something which we have mentioned, but we'll mention it again because of its importance. When you have a general ruling taken from a general ayah or hadith, and then you have another hadith or an ayah which mentions specific items of the generality, then this is not a takhsis, because a takhsis is when you take out certain items of the generality. To illustrate this with an example, we know that the earth is a means of tayammum for us. And so this includes everything on the layer of the earth, whether it be sand, stone, dust, mud, anything which is natural earth on the surface. But we have another narration in the Sahih in which the Prophet said that the dust of the earth has been made as a means of purification for us. So is this a takhsis, meaning to say that only the dust can be used and nothing else from the earth? The answer is no, this is not a takhsis. Rather, this hadith is simply mentioning certain items of the generality, and it is not making an exception. So the generality still holds, and there is no exception made. Another example, the Prophet ﷺ said, Diyatul kafir aw aqlul kafir nisfu aqlil muslim. The blood money of a kafir is half of that of the Muslim. And in another wording, he says, Diyatul kitabi nisfu aqlil muslim. The blood money of a kitabi, meaning a Jew or a Christian, is half that of the Muslim. Is this a takhsis? Meaning to say, not every kafir has his blood money half of the Muslim, but rather only the kitabi, which is the Yahudi or the Nasrani. We say, no, this is not a takhsis. It is simply mentioning certain items of the generality. And from the generality of the kuffar are the Ahlul Kitab. Otherwise, the generality still holds in that the blood money of the kafir is half that of the Muslim. So for a kafir male is half that of the Muslim male, and for the kafir female is half that of the Muslim female. So the question you might ask is, how do we tell whether a takhsis is being made or not? The way to tell is that when the specific hadith is mentioned, if it is taking the same ruling as the ruling of the general hadith or evidence, then this is not a takhsis. As for when the specific hadith is taking on a different ruling to the generality, then this is a takhsis. And you can compare the examples which we gave with the zakah example and this diyah example, the blood money example. The zakah example is giving a different ruling and the diyah example is giving the same ruling. Another example found in the Sunan, the Prophet ﷺ said, الإسبال في الإزار والقميص والعمامة من جر منها شيئا خيلاء لم ينظر الله إليه. That إسبال is done with the إزار, the قميص, and the عمامة. Whoever drags any of it out of pride, then Allah will not look at him. This hadith mentions a general statement and a specific statement. The general statement which it mentions is that al-isbal is done with the izar, with the qamis, and with the imama. Isbal with the lower clothing is when you let it drag down below the ankles. And then the hadith goes on to say, whoever drags any of these with pride or self-conceit, then Allah will not look at him. So some people would say that this hadith is specifically talking about dragging your clothing on the ground with pride. But this is not the case, because the first part of the hadith is general, and it says al-isbal. So you're not allowed to have your qamis or your izar or your amama go down below the ankle. But if you were to drag it with pride, then Allah will not look at you. So this hadith is mentioning a generality and a specific aspect of that generality, which in this case is dragging the clothing on the floor. So we say they are both haram. To have your clothing below the ankle, whether you're wearing trousers or qamis or izar or whatever clothing you're wearing, you're not allowed to have it below the ankle, because this is isbal. And then if you were to drag it on the ground out of pride, then this is even worse, because Allah will not look at you. Otherwise, anything of your clothing which is below the ankle is in the fire, as is stated in the hadith. Even though the hadith mentions the izar, and it does not mention any other item of clothing, all other items of clothing take the same ruling, because in those days people would wear the izar as opposed to anything else. And this was normally the case. And so the Prophet is talking about what is normally the case in the place in which he was living in at that time. But in our times, if it is normally the case that people wear trousers, then the same ruling applies. Because it is the underlying meaning of the hadith which we look at, not necessarily the wordings. And we can also illustrate this with a simple example. If somebody tells you, give all of the students a book, and then he tells you, give Zayd a book, and we know that Zayd is one of the students, is this a takhsis or not? So that you only give Zayd the book? Of course, this is not a takhsis. Rather, you give all the students a book, and you give Zayd a book. So this is not a takhsis at all. But if he was to tell you, give all of the students a book, and then he tells you, do not give Zayd a book, then in this case, this is a takhsis, because the two statements have different rulings. Whereas in the first instance, they had the same ruling. So if they have the same ruling, it is not a takhsis. If they have a different ruling, then it is a takhsis. Another example on which there is a big difference of opinion is that some ulama say that when it comes to jewelry made out of silver, there is no zakah on this, because this is for personal use. And they use as their evidence the narration in the Sahih, وَفِي الرِّقَ رُبْعُ الْعُشْرِ. And on the riqa, you have to pay a quarter of a tenth, which means a 40th, or 2.5%. They say the word riqa is silver which has been made into a shape of coins, so you use it as money. It does not mean any old silver, like silver for jewelry. So therefore, zakah is only on that silver used for money, and not on the silver used for personal use. So they say that this makes a takhsis, an exception to the general rule. Because we have general evidences which say that anyone who has gold or silver and he does not pay zakah on it, then plates will be made for him of gold and silver heated on hellfire, and he will be branded with it, his sides, his front and his back, on Yawm al-Qiyamah for 50,000 years until the judgment is passed, and then he sees his way to Jannah or Jahannam. So the evidence is am, it is general, it includes all types of gold and silver. But they say that this hadith makes an exception because it is talking about just the silver used for money, meaning the coins. The first answer against this is something which Ibn Hazm gave, and he said that riqa also includes all types of silver, not just money. So he took it from a language standpoint of view, that in the Arabic language, riqa can mean all types of silver, so there is no takhsis. But even if we say, okay, riqa only means the coins, but let's apply this to our principle. Remember, our principle is when some items of the generality are mentioned with the same ruling as the general evidence, then this is not a takhsis. So let's apply this here. The general evidence tells us we have to pay zakah on gold and silver, whatever the gold and silver may be. This evidence mentions a particular item of the generality, which in this case are silver coins. And it is telling us that you have to pay the zakah on it. Now we ask ourselves, is the ruling the same between the general evidence and the specific evidence? The answer is yes, the ruling is the same, you have to pay zakah. So if the ruling is the same, this is not a takhsis, because a takhsis can only happen when the ruling is different. This is the key. Now we move on to the fourth category, and this is when we have a collision between two evidences. They are both general, but one evidence is more general than the other from one aspect and more specific than the other from another aspect. And then the second evidence likewise, it is more general than the first evidence from one aspect but more specific than the first evidence from another aspect. So basically we have two evidences, they both have a generality and they both have a specific aspect to it. So in a situation like this, we have three steps. Step number one is that we have to look elsewhere for another evidence, an external independent evidence, which could help us make a takhsis. To illustrate this with an example, Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 234, والذين يتوفون منكم ويذرون أزواجا يتربصن بأنفسهن أربعة أشهر وعشرا. Those of you who die and leave behind wives, then they wait in the waiting period for 4 months and 10 days. This ayah has a generality and a specific aspect, so it is am and khas at the same time. How is this? First of all, it is am because it is talking about all types of women who have their husbands die and leave them behind. They are to wait 4 months and 10 days. So this includes a woman who is pregnant, and it includes a woman who is not pregnant, because it is general. She has to wait 4 months and 10 days. So this is the general aspect, but it also has a specific aspect, because this 4 months and 10 days is specific to that woman who has her husband died. Otherwise, if a woman is divorced, she does not have to wait 4 months and 10 days. So we see that there is a general aspect and a specific aspect. Now take this ayah from Surah At-Talaq. He says, وَأُولَاتُ الْأَحْمَالِ أَجْلُهُنَّ أَن يَضَعْنَ حَمْلَهُنَّ. And the waiting period of those who are pregnant is up until they deliver their load, meaning give birth. Again, this has a general aspect and a specific aspect. What is this? The general aspect is that it includes all types of women, whether she is divorced or whether her husband has died. So it is general. And it also has a specific aspect, in that this ruling is of course specific to those who are pregnant, and not just any other woman. Otherwise, if a woman is divorced, she would have to wait for 3 menstrual cycles, as is well known. So now we find that both of these evidences have a general aspect and a specific aspect. That's fine, there is no contradiction, except what happens when a woman is pregnant and her husband dies. The question is, does she have to wait for 4 months and 10 days, which is what the first evidence told us, or does she have to wait up until she gives birth, which is what the second evidence is telling us? Here we seem to have a contradiction between the two evidences, and there doesn't seem to be anything to decide. So what do we do now, because we seem to be in a chock-a-block situation? What we need to do is to look at the rest of the evidences and see if we can find a third evidence which could help us out and resolve this issue. This is where it is not good enough for us to say that we solely depend on the Qur'an without the hadith. Because in this issue we find that there is a hadith in the Sahih which resolved this issue for us. If we were to ignore the hadith, it would be difficult to resolve issues. We find in the Sahih that a woman called Subay'ah al-Aslamiyya, she gave birth a few nights after her husband died. And after she gave birth, she ended her waiting period and wore normal clothing and dressed herself up for the suitors. And so a man called Abu Sanabil told her that you will not be able to marry until you wait 4 months and 10 days in accordance with the order of the Qur'an. And so she went to the Prophet ﷺ to ask him about this. And the Prophet said, كَذَبَ أَبُو السَّنَابِلِ. Abu Sanabil has lied. And he told her that she is free to marry whenever she wants. So therefore we find that if a woman gives birth before 4 months and 10 days after her husband dies, then her waiting period ends when she gives birth, not with the 4 months and 10 days. And so with this we can resolve the issue. Otherwise, it has been narrated that Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abdullah ibn Abbas gave the verdict that if a woman is pregnant and her husband dies, then her waiting period is the longer of the two waiting periods. So if it's 4 months and 10 days, then she waits that much. And if it is up until she gives birth, then she waits up until that long. So they say it is the longer of the two periods, to be on the safe side. However, despite Abdullah ibn Abbas and Ali ibn Abi Talib being two scholars of the companions, their viewpoint contradicts this authentic hadith. And so we cannot take the opinion of these two great companions, and we go with what is authentic from the Prophet ﷺ. The second step is that if you do not find a third evidence which makes a takhsis, then you have to choose the rajih, the weightier of the two opinions. And this is when you look for indications in the Sharia which could tell us that one evidence is weightier than the other. An example to illustrate this, the hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا دَخَلَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَسْجِدِ فَلَا يَجْلِسْ حَتَّى يُصَلِّيَ رَقْعَتَيْنِ. When one of you enters the masjid, he must not sit down until he prays 2 rak'at. This evidence is general and specific. It is general for any time. Any time you enter the masjid, you must pray the tahiyyatul masjid, the greeting of the masjid prayer, as it is called. And it is specific in the sense that it is only for the greeting of the masjid. So it is this specific prayer prayed at any time. So there's a specific aspect and the general aspect, which is the time. Then we have another hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, لا صلاة بعد الصبح حتى تطلع الشمس ولا صلاة بعد العصر حتى تغرب الشمس. there is no salah after subh, which is the salat of subh, until the sun rises, and there is no salah after asr, until the sun sets. And this evidence is general in that it includes all types of prayer. So all types of prayer are not allowed to be prayed in these particular times. And it is also specific in the sense that it is for these specific times. So he did not say there is no salah at any time. No, rather it is specific to these particular periods of time. So we can see that both of these evidences have a general aspect and a specific aspect. The first evidence was general with the time but specific with the prayer. And the second evidence was specific with the time and general with the prayer. And in this issue, we do not seem to find a text from the Qur'an or Hadith which makes a takhsis in the same way we found in the first category. So we move on to the next step, which is to take what is rajih, the weightier of the two evidences. And this is done by looking at other indications in the Sharia, which could give us some clues and hints. Both of these evidences can be worked with on their own, except the point is, if somebody enters the masjid in these prohibited times, does he pray Tahiyyatul Masjid or not? The first hadith tells us that you must pray because it is general for all times. And the second hadith says you must not pray because that hadith in the prohibition of the prayer is general for all types of prayers, be it Tahiyyatul Masjid, be it a fard prayer, nafil prayer, any type of prayer. So here we have a contradiction. So what is the rajih in this issue? We say that the rajih is that he does pray the Tahiyyatul Masjid in the prohibited times. How can we say this when we don't have a third independent evidence which will judge this case for us? Yes, we do not have a third independent evidence, but we do have other indications in the Sharia which tell us that the generality of the hadith of Tahiyyatul Masjid is stronger than the generality of the hadith which tells us not to pray in those specific times. If we say that the Tahiyyatul Masjid is mustahab, which is what most of the scholars say, then this is not a problem, because if you were to enter the masjid between Salat al-Subh and sunrise, then you simply can sit down and you don't need to pray Tahiyyatul Masjid, because it is not wajib anyway. But if we were to say that Tahiyyatul Masjid is wajib, which is also an opinion of the scholars, then you will need the rajih. So we say that the generality of the second evidence, which tells us not to pray in those prohibited times, this is weaker because it has exceptions made to it. For example, if you forget to pray your fard prayer and then you remember, but you remember in these prohibited times, do you pray in these prohibited times or not? The answer is, it is wajib for you to pray immediately. And this is what the Prophet ordered, that if you forget your prayer or sleep through it, then you need to pray whenever you remember, be it in the forbidden times or not. So this is an exception which is made. Likewise, if Salat al-Jama'ah has been done, and then a new group of people come to the masjid, and they want to pray, and so they decide to pray in the Jama'ah, as a second Jama'ah. But this happens to be after Salat al-Subh, so this is in the prohibited times. Can they do this or not? The answer is yes, they can do this. And we have a specific evidence for this. In the Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmad, when the Prophet ﷺ prayed Salat al-Subh, and afterwards he saw two people who did not pray. They were behind. And so he called them, and they were shaking in fear, and he asked them why they did not pray, and they told the Prophet, we have already prayed in our houses. So when we came to the masjid, we didn't pray because we have already prayed. And so the Prophet told them, إِذَا صَلَّيْتُمَا فِي رِحَالِكُمَا ثُمَّ أَدَيْتُمَا مَسْجِدَ جَمَاعَةٍ فَصَلِّيَا مَعَهُمْ فَإِنَّهَا لَكُمَا نَافِلًا. When you pray in your houses or your homes, and then you come to the masjid in which the jama'ah is being held, then pray with them, meaning repeat this prayer, because this second prayer will be a nafila for you. So you've already prayed your fard, say your salat al-subh at home, and then when you come to the masjid, they are praying the salat al-subh, so pray with the jama'ah, it will be a nafila for you. So here clearly they are praying after salat al-subh, and it is a nafila. So this is a clear exception to the general rule in the hadith which talks about forbidding the prayer. So this evidence weakens the generality of the hadith which forbids the prayer during the forbidden times. So we find in this situation that the generality of the second hadith is weaker. And because it is weaker, it does not stand up against the generality of the hadith ordering Tahiyyatul Masjid. And on this note, some ulama of Usul al-Fiqh have said that every time you have a general evidence and it is specified by a specific evidence, then the generality of the general evidence no longer stands. So it cannot be taken as a general evidence anymore. Why do they say this? They say that because it has been specified, and we know that it's not general anymore, because it has been specified, they say this proves that the generality in the evidence was not intended in the first place. So if it can be specified by one issue, then let it also be specified by another issue, and this is likely. So they say that this general evidence could be specified by many issues. And if this is the case, then its generality no longer stands, so it is no longer am or general. However, the correct opinion is no, the generality does stand, and we only make specifications where the Sharia makes specifications. Otherwise, we leave it as a general statement. And this is much more in accordance with the order of the Prophet. Because if the Prophet gave us something general, then we take it as general. And we are not allowed to make exceptions where the Sharia does not make exceptions. And this is closer to strictly following the Prophet. And just going back to the Tahiyatul Masjid, the reason why the Prophet ﷺ forbade praying after Salatul Subh and after Salatul Maghrib is because the sun rises and sets after these times, and this is when the sun worshippers would make their prayer. So it is to prevent the Muslims from imitating the sun worshippers. However, if you are praying a prayer for which there is a known reason, then this imitation no longer features, because it is well known why you are praying what you are praying. Whether it be Tahiyatul Masjid, or repeating the prayer with the Jama'ah, if you have already prayed at home, or whatever the specific reason would be, this is the reason why you're praying this prayer. So you are no longer imitating the Kuffar. So logically, this ruling also makes sense. So what about Salatul Istikhara? Can this be prayed in the forbidden times? We say it depends. If you're making Salatul Istikhara for an issue for which you need a decision before the forbidden time ends, then we say in this case, pray in the forbidden time. As for if it is pertaining to an issue which can wait, then we say wait until after the forbidden time. So if you're praying Salatul Istikhara for an issue of marriage, whether the partner would be the right person, then in this case we can say pray until after the forbidden time because this issue can wait. It is not so desperate that it needs to be known before the forbidden time ends. What about the sunnah of the wudu? When you make wudu to pray the two raka'at sunnah. If you made wudu and this was in the prohibited times, can you pray this salah in the prohibited time? The answer is yes, because this is done for a specific reason, which is the wudu. However, if somebody deliberately makes wudu in the prohibited times in order to pray this salatul wudu, then what's the ruling here? We say in this case, your intention is that you want to make haram into halal. Hence, you are not allowed to do this, and you're not allowed to pray this prayer. Because this is a hila, a device or a strategy which you come up with to get around the ruling of the Sharia. It is a similar case when, if a person is married and it is Ramadan and he is not patient, he needs to have intercourse with his wife. And so to get around it, he travels. And we know when you travel, you don't have to fast. And also you're allowed to have intercourse therefore. But he travels in order to have intercourse with his wife during the daytime of Ramadan. We say, no, this traveling of yours is haram because it is a hila, a clever little device or a strategy for you to make halal what is haram. And if we say that your traveling is haram, then everything which results from your traveling is also not permissible. So you're not allowed to shorten your prayer to two rak'at. Neither are you allowed to wipe over the socks for 3 days and nights. And neither are you allowed to combine between the prayers. So you are not allowed to enjoy the rukhsa of traveling because your traveling itself is haram. In a similar case, somebody does not want to attend the Salatul Jama'ah. So he intentionally eats onions or garlic to give him this bad breath, and so he does not need to attend the Jama'ah. But this is a hila because he did this deliberately to evade Salatul Jama'ah. We say, yes, you do not go to the masjid because this is haram, however, you are sinful for doing so. And your punishment is the same as the punishment who intentionally leaves off Salatul Jama'ah whilst he is living close enough to the masjid to attend. But as for if somebody ate onions or garlic or leek just because he wants to eat it, but not because he wants to evade Salatul Jama'ah, then we say to him, in this case, you are not sinful. However, we say you have missed the reward for Salatul Jama'ah. And so if you cannot find a murajjih, something to make one of the two evidences rajih, then in this case, you move to the third step, which is that you work in accordance with the generality of both evidences in the area which they do not collide. As for the area which they contradict each other, then you refrain from giving a ruling, because you're not allowed to speak about that which you have no knowledge. However, this third step is relative, because whereas one scholar may not be able to reconcile between the evidences or find what is rajih, another scholar may well be able to. And we know the Sharia came down to make things clear and plain, not to cause contradiction and confusion. And so because of this, we do not find any real example to illustrate this third step, except if it does happen to you that you cannot make a reconciliation between two evidences, they are both general and specific, then you simply refrain from giving a ruling. And people are of various levels in their understanding of the text of the Sharia. May Allah Jalla Ala open up the doors for us to understand the text of the Sharia. And when we say you refrain from giving a ruling, this is on the assumption that you are a mujtahid scholar. This is not on the assumption that you are just a normal Muslim who doesn't really know too much about the deen, which is what most Muslims are. So as for if you are just an ammi, then you ask a scholar. But the point with a ammi is that he needs to ask a scholar whether the evidences contradict with him, or even if they don't contradict, because it could be that he is misunderstanding the evidence which he thinks are not contradictory. So either way, he has to refer the matter to a scholar. So we say in summary that if you have a contradiction between two evidences, then the first thing to do is to try to make al-jama', which is reconciliation, where you carry both of the evidences and work by both of them and make them agree with each other. If this is not possible, then we move to an-nasq, if we know the dates. If we don't know the dates, we move to the evidence which is rajih. Practically, there is little difference between an-nasq and at-tarjih, because in both cases, you are not working with one of the evidences. It's just that with an-nasq, you know the date. And with al-rajih, you don't know the dates, but rather you look at other indications in the Sharia, which could give you clues as to which of the evidences is the weightier. And if you cannot even do that, then you have to refrain from giving a ruling. And this is the case for a mujtahid, of course. But what if you have an issue in which both the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma' and Qiyas are giving the same ruling? Do we say that the evidence for this issue is the ijma' of the scholars based upon the Qur'an and the Sunnah? Or do we say that the evidence for this issue is the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the ijma' and the Qiyas? So which style do we use? Because there's a difference of opinion. Some scholars say we use the first and others say we use the second. But the better opinion is we use the second. So for example, we could say that trade is permissible. What's the evidence for this? We would not say because Allah said so and because the Messenger said and because there is a need for trade. Rather, we would say the evidence for this is supported by the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma' and the Qiyas. Some scholars say that you simply say that the evidence is al-Ijma' based upon the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Because when you say it like this, then nobody could argue back, because you're not allowed to argue against the Ijma'. And we discussed this issue in the chapter of al-Ijma'. But the point is, it's better to detail it out. And this is how you find in most of the reliable books of fiqh, that they will say that this issue is permissible, and the evidence is the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma' and the Qiyas. So we would say that trade is halal, because we find evidence in the Qur'an. Allah says, وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعُ Allah has made bay' halal. And we have it from the hadith, many ahadith. For example, إِذَا تَبَايَعَ الرَّجُلَانِ فَكُلُّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا بِالْخِيَارِ مَعْلَمْ يَتَفَرَّقَا When two men enter into a trade contract, then they both have a choice to annul it as long as they have not parted company. And we can say there is also an ijma' of the scholars that trade is allowed. Of course, when it comes to certain details of the trade, there could be differences of opinion. But as for trade being allowed or not, then everybody agrees this is allowed. Likewise, al-qiyas, which is much more of a logical evidence, if somebody needs something and another person possesses it, then either this person can take this item from him by killing him, by robbing him, but both of these are haram. So what's the alternative? You have to buy it from him. Unless he gives it to you as a gift, but that's something different. So this is the order we go by: Qur'an, Sunnah, Ijma' and Qiyas. These are the four evidences of the Sharia. Somebody might ask, why do you put the Qur'an first and the Sunnah second? Isn't it true that both the Qur'an and the Sunnah are of equal status when it comes to extracting rulings? We say yes, certainly. The Sunnah is of equal status with the Qur'an when it comes to extracting rulings. However, the difference between the Qur'an and the Sunnah is that every ayah of the Qur'an is mutawatir, but not every Sunnah is mutawatir. There could be some Sunnah which is mutawatir and some are ahad. And from the ahad, you can have those which are sahih, hasan or da'if, or even fabricated. So when it comes to the Sunnah, some scholar may disagree with you as to the authenticity of the hadith. With him it might be da'if, with you it could be sahih, or vice versa. But as with the Qur'an, nobody can dispute that it is all authentic. So this puts the Qur'an in a stronger position than the Sunnah. So the only argument which you could have with regards to the Qur'an is, are you extracting the ruling properly or not? Whereas with the hadith, you have two points of argument. First of all, is it authentic or not? And secondly, even if it is authentic, are you extracting the ruling properly or not? So with the hadith, we have two points of argument, and with the Qur'an, there can only be one. What if you have a case when, out of these four sources of law in the Sharia, only one of them is proving a ruling, but the other three are not? We say yes, we affirm the ruling, because they are all sources of the ruling. So as long as there is nothing contradicting this ruling from the other sources, then we affirm it. But what if there are contradictions, and maybe one source is giving you one ruling and another source is giving you another ruling? So we have a contradiction and a collision, then in this case we do what we have said, we try to make al-jama', if not then an-nasf, if not then at-tarjih, and if not then we keep quiet, which is at-tawakkuf, which means you stop and you refrain from giving a ruling, and you simply say Allah knows best. The jama' and the nasf are straightforward enough, and as for at-tawakkuf, this is also straightforward, you simply refrain from giving a ruling. But as for at-tarjih, then we said that we have to look at other indications in the Sharia which could help us out to give weight to one argument over and above the other. There are many ways in which this can be done. So let's look at this topic of at-tarjih and discuss some of the indications in the Sharia which could help us. So the first way we're going to look at is when two evidences collide with each other and one evidence is a nas and the other one is a zahir. Remember we spoke about nas and zahir. A nas is a text which only carries one meaning, and that's it. It is sarih, singular in meaning. As for a text which is a zahir, then this could carry one or more meaning, but one of the meanings is weightier than the other meanings. So the other meanings are secondary meanings. For example, the word asad, which means lion, but it can also mean a brave man, depending on the context. So the primary meaning, or what is apparent, is a lion. But it can also mean, as a secondary meaning, a brave man. So, if we have a collision between two texts, one is a nas and the other is a zahir, then if we have to make a tarjih, then we give precedence to the nas over and above the zahir. Let's give an example. Is zakah on jewelry made out of gold or silver to be given or not to be given? Difference of opinion on this issue. But we say that the correct opinion is that it is to be given, even though this jewelry made of gold or silver is for personal use. But zakah on gold and silver must be given in all circumstances, whether this gold or silver is for money or for personal use. We have two evidences. One is am and the other one is khas. As for the evidence which is khas, then it is the hadith reported in the Sunan, and it is classified sahih by Ibn al-Qattan, where a woman came to the Prophet ﷺ, and she had her daughter with her, and this daughter was wearing two bracelets made of gold. And the Prophet asked her, do you pay zakah on these bracelets? And she said no. And the Prophet then said to her, أَيَسُرُّكِ أَنْ يُسَوِّرَكِ اللَّهُ بِهِمَا سِوَارَيْنِ مِنْ نَارِ. Will it please you that Allah makes two bracelets of fire for you? And then she took these bracelets and threw them to the Prophet, and she said, this is for Allah and the Messenger. So this hadith is very specific in saying that you must give zakah on your jewelry, in this case it's bracelets, if they are made of gold. And as long as the hadith is authentic, which it is, then we work by it. Because this is singular in meaning. There are no two ways about it. There is another hadith which talks about the fact that there is no one who owns gold or silver and he does not give it zakah, except that plates will be made for him, heated on the hellfire, and he will be branded on his forehead, his sides, his front and his back for 50,000 years until judgment is passed. And then he will see his way to Jannah or Jahannam. So this hadith is am. It talks about all types of gold and silver. But because this hadith is am, somebody could easily come along and say, no, this is am, but we have exceptions made to the generality. So this am hadith can include more than one meaning, and it can be argued against, therefore. But as for the hadith which is khas, then nobody could argue against it. Nobody can say that there is any exceptions made to this, because this hadith itself is khas. So the difference between an-nas and al-zahir is that with an-nas, what you see is what you get. With al-zahir, there is room for arguments, because it carries more than one meaning, and it is a bit more flexible in the way in which it can be interpreted, but not with an-nas. So that was the first comparison between an-nas and al-zahir. Second comparison between al-zahir and al-mu'awwal. And we spoke about these words earlier on in the presentation. Zahir and Mu'awwal are two opposites. When a word contains one or more meaning, the more likely meaning is Al-Zahir and the less likely meaning is Al-Mu'awwal, which means interpreted. So when these two types of evidences clash, then the tarjih is that you give precedence to the Zahir over and above the Mu'awwal, because we have to go by what is Zahir or apparent from the text. An example to illustrate this point, the hadith, لا نكاح إلا بولي. There is no nikah except with a wali. This statement contains a zahir meaning and a mu'awwal meaning. What is zahir from this sentence is that any nikah without the wali of the woman is fasid and its presence is like its absence. The mu'awwal meaning is that a nikah without a wali is correct and it can go ahead, but it is not the perfect type of nikah, so it is deficient. We say in this case we have a clash between zahir and mu'awwal, so we give precedence to that which is zahir. And this is an important rule to know, because many people of deviancy will take a word which could carry a zahir meaning and a mu'awwal meaning, and they will carry it on the mu'awwal meaning to argue in their favor. So you need to be able to distinguish that which is zahir and that which is mu'awwal, and we give precedence to that which is zahir. The reason why this is zahir is because when the Prophet says la nikah, there is no nikah, then the primary meaning is there is no physical nikah. But it cannot mean that, because clearly you can have a physical nikah without a wali. So we move on to the second meaning, which is that it is not sahih and it is fasid. If this does not work, then we move on to the third meaning, which is that it is not complete, meaning done in the perfect way. So out of these three alternatives, we find the first one doesn't work. So we move to the second one. Does that work? Yes, it does work. So we do not need to move to the third option, which is the mu'awwal meaning, and we stick to the zahir meaning. The third point is that we give precedence to the manduq over and above the mafhum. What's the difference? Manduq is that which is uttered. Basically, this is the what you see is what you get from the hadith. So these are the words which are uttered by the hadith or the evidence. The mafhum is simply the antithesis to that particular evidence, be it a hadith or an ayah. So this is the converse argument, or we could say the flip side of the coin. To illustrate this with an example, we find in the authentic hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ الْمَاءَ طَهُورٌ لَا يُنَجِّسُهُ شَيْءٌ, that water is purifying and nothing makes it impure. So the manduq of this hadith is that water is purifying, so you can make wudu from it and make ghusl from it also, and nothing makes it impure. So whether the water is in large amounts or small amounts, nothing will make it impure. So this is the manduq. This is the what you see is what you get. Then we have another authentic hadith in which the Prophet said, إِذَا بَلَغَ الْمَاءُ قُلَّتَيْنْ لَمْ يَنْجُسْ, when water reaches the level of two qulla, which are two great containers, then it does not become impure. So what is manduq from this hadith is that if the water reaches qullatayn, then it doesn't become impure. But what is mafhum from this hadith, the flip side of the coin, or the antithesis, is that if it is less than two qulla, then it can become impure, if there is some impurity which affects the water. So now in this case we have a contradiction between manduq and mafhum. The manduq of the first hadith telling us that no amount of water will become impure if some impurity comes into it. But the mafhum of the second hadith is telling us if the water is less than two qulla, then it will become impure if some impurity enters into it, regardless of whether it changes the color, taste and smell of the water. As long as the water is less than two qulla and some impurity comes into it, and it does not even change the smell, taste and color, it will still become impure. So there's a clash between manduq and mafhum. So we give precedence to the manduq, because this is clearer for us to understand. The mafhum is a weaker form of argument. So we say in this issue, we do not make a takhsis to the generality of the first hadith, which tells us that nothing makes the water impure, because we cannot make a takhsis of a manduq using an evidence which is mafhum, because the mafhum does not stand up against the manduq. As for if we were to make an exception by saying, no, water can be made impure if some impurity enters into this water, changing its taste, smell or color, we say yes, this is a takhsis, but in this case we have a particular hadith which makes a takhsis. In other words, we have a manduq of a hadith which makes an exception to the manduq of this hadith. And in the language, manduq means that which is spoken or uttered. Then the fourth point, from the hints which could give us a clue to make tarjih, is that we give precedence to the muthbit over the nafi. The muthbit is an evidence which affirms a ruling, and the nafi is an evidence which negates a ruling. So that which affirms is given precedence to that which negates. And this is because that which affirms is giving us more knowledge. But as for that which negates, then perhaps somebody is negating something because he simply has no knowledge of it. To illustrate this with an example, in everyday life, if we are expecting the arrival of a person called Ahmed, and we are waiting for him, so he has not arrived yet. And two people come to us giving us some information about Ahmed, and these two people are standing before us. One of them tells us, Ahmed has not arrived yet. And the other one tells us, Ahmed has arrived. And they are both trustworthy people. So what they say is authentic. Which one will we give precedence to? We give precedence to the one who is making an affirmation. Why? Because he has extra knowledge which he is giving us. As for the one who is making a negation, saying that Ahmed has not arrived yet, then he's not telling us anything new, because we know already that Ahmed has not arrived. This is why we are waiting for him. So we take the affirmation because it is giving us more information and knowledge. An example from the Sharia to illustrate this point, fasting the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And we of course mean the first 9 days, because you do not fast on the day of Eid. We have a narration from Aisha radiallahu anha in Sahih Muslim. She says that she never saw the Prophet fasting these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. But we have another narration in the Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmad, in which Hafsa radiallahu anha says that there are 4 things which the Prophet never left out. And she mentions that from them there were the Siyam of Ashura and also the Siyam of the 10 days, meaning of Dhul Hijjah. On the statement that this narration is authentic, we say that one is giving a negation and the other one, meaning this one in Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmad, is giving an affirmation. So we give precedence to the affirmation over and above the negation, because the affirmation is giving us more information. However, this could be argued back, because people could say that the narration in the Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmad is not authentic. But that's a different debate entirely. We are just assuming that both of these narrations are authentic. And of course the first one, which is a statement of Aisha, is found in Sahih Muslim. The fifth point to mention is that when you have two evidences, one takes you away from the asl and the other one keeps you on the asl. So you give precedence to the one which is taking you away from the asl, because again, it is giving you more information. So this category is similar to category number 4. By way of an example is the Prophet ﷺ saying to the person who asked him that he touched his private parts, does he have to make wudu? And the Prophet told him, إِنَّمَا هُوَ بَضْعَةٌ مِنْكَ. It is only a part of you. So he told him, no, he doesn't have to, because what you touched is only a part of you. So it's like you touching your ear or your head or your arms or any other part of your body. Of course, this will not break your wudu. However, we have another hadith, and this is also authentic, in which the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ مَسَّ ذَكَرَهُ فَلْيَتَوَضَّ. Whoever touches his private parts, then let him make wudu. So we have two hadith. One is keeping us on the asl, that your wudu is not broken. And the second hadith is taking us away from the asl, which is that if you touch your private parts, then you must make wudu. So from the ulama are those who have made tarjih, and they say that the hadith which orders you to make wudu is rajih, and the other one we do not work by. Because the one which is ordering you to make wudu is taking you away from the asl. Because even if we did not have the hadith which tells you that you do not need to make wudu after touching your private parts, we would still hold the ruling that you do not need to make wudu after touching the private parts, because that's the asl, that's the original ruling in the very first place. So the other hadith is giving us extra information, so we go by that. So this is if you make tarjih. However, you can easily say that you don't need to make tarjih, because you can simply make a jama', a reconciliation. And there are two ways which you can do this. Firstly, you can say that the hadith which orders you to make wudu is out of istihbab, so it's recommended to make wudu, and it is not wajib. So based upon this, if you touch your private parts, you don't have to make wudu, but if you do, then it is better. So here we can work with both a hadith, and we do not need to leave one hadith and take the other. Or the second way to make a jama' is to say that if you touch your private parts with a desire, then this breaks the wudu, but if you touch it just normally, without desire, then this would be like touching any other part of the body. Hence, it would not break the wudu. And what further supports this is that we know when the Prophet ﷺ would make ghusl, then he would begin with the wudu and then he would wash the rest of his body. And we know that he used to use small amounts of water to wash the body. And in the narration in the Sahih, he used to use 4 or 5 amdad, which is the plural of mud, which is what you can hold approximately in 2 handfuls. And we're talking about average sized hands. But the point is that he would make wudu and then wash the rest of his body with small amount of water. So there's no doubt that he would have to touch all of his body with the wet hand so that the whole body can be cleansed with water and that water can run on the whole of the body. Because it will be impossible for him to pour the water and make it run on the whole of his body when the amount of water he is using is so small. So no doubt he would have to touch his private parts to wash them. But it's not been narrated that he made wudu again, because he did not touch his private parts with desire. So this could support the second opinion. However, this argument could be argued back, and somebody could say, yes, but before the Prophet took a bath, we know that he would clean his private parts first from any effects of the janaba, and then he would make wudu, and then he would wash the rest of his body. So it could well be that he did not touch his private parts because he touched them when he was cleaning them before he made the wudu. But in any case, both of these 2 reconciliations are acceptable. The 6th point of giving precedence to the adillah is when you have 2 evidences which are both am, but one am is preserved, so it is a stronger generality, and the other am has exceptions made to it, so that generality is weaker. So basically, 2 evidences, they are both general, but one is stronger in its generality than the other, because the weaker generality has certain exceptions which are made. So if this is the case, then we give precedence to the evidence which is stronger in its generality. And we mentioned before the statement of some of the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, when if an evidence which is general has exceptions made to it, then we cannot take it as a general evidence. Because if it has certain exceptions made to it, then how do you know there are also other exceptions not made? So if that's the case, then they say we cannot take it as a general evidence, all-encompassing. However, the stronger opinion is that we make exceptions wherever the Sharia make exceptions, and we carry it on a general meaning whenever the Sharia carries it on the general meaning. Because this is closer to following the text of the Sharia. As for an example, this is something which we have given. One hadith tells us that when you enter the masjid, you must not sit down until you pray 2 rak'at. So this is general for any time. And the other hadith tells us that there is no salah, meaning no valid salah, after salat al-subh until the sun rises, and after salat al-asr until the sun completely sets. So this hadith now is general for all types of prayer, whether it be tahiyyat al-masjid or other than that. So now we have a case of 2 generalities clashing with each other. Because what happens when you enter the masjid in the forbidden times? Which generality do you give precedence to? The general evidence which says no salah in these times, or the general evidence which says tahiyyatul masjid at any time? So now we need to ask ourselves, which generality is stronger? When we look at the hadith which forbids the prayer in those timings, we find that this has many exceptions made. For example, if you make tawaf and you have to pray the salah at the Maqam Ibrahim, then if this needs to be done during the forbidden times, then it's permissible. Likewise, repeating the Salat al-Jama'ah for people who are late, this is permissible. And we mentioned the particular hadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, which is Sahih, about the 2 people who did not pray in Salat al-Jama'ah, and this was in Masjid al-Khayf in Mina. And the excuse they gave was that they prayed in their homes, and the Prophet told them that if you pray in your homes and you come to the Salat al-Jama'ah, then pray with them, it will be a nafilah for you. And this prayer, which the Prophet was praying, was Salat al-Subh. So therefore, this would have been in the prohibited time. Likewise, if you have to pray Salat al-Kusuf after Asr, then this could be done. So the generality is weaker. Somebody could argue, is it not the case that when the Imam comes to the masjid on Yawm al-Jum'ah, then he sits down on the minbar and he does not pray Tahiyyatul Masjid? And this is the Sunnah which we know from the Prophet. We say, yes, okay, this is an exception, but this is only one exception. As for the other hadith, it has many exceptions. And even with this one exception, you could argue that the khutbah is like the introductory phase to the salah. So it's like the Imam comes to the masjid, gives the khutbah, and then he prays. So here we could possibly find an excuse for the Imam for not praying the Tahiyyatul Masjid, because the khutbah takes its place. And this is a very specific occasion. But even if we, for argument's sake, say that, yes, this is an exception, it is only one exception. Hence the same rule holds, which is that the generality which tells you to pray the Tahiyatul Masjid is stronger than the generality which prohibits you from praying Tahiyatul Masjid in the forbidden times. Other examples of At-Takhsis is if you are combining between the Dhuhr and Asr during the time of Asr, then what about the Sunnahs which are prayed after the Dhuhr? It is permissible to pray them after Asr, but of course this would be in the forbidden time. However, this is an exception. Likewise, if you forgot the Fard prayer and you remember in the forbidden time, again, you could pray it in the forbidden time. In fact, you are obliged to do so. And we spoke about Salat al-Istikhara, and we said on this issue there is some detail. Is it a desperate issue which you are in or not? It depends on your circumstances. The seventh way from the methods of At-Tarjih is when you have two hadith which are colliding. One is Shadh and the other one is Mahfuz. We know that a Shadh hadith is one which is authentic in its chain of narration, but it is in collision with a hadith which is more authentic, either because the men in the chain of narration have better memory, or because there are more trustworthy narrators in the other hadith. So we have, let's say, two chains of narration for two different hadith, and they are giving us two different rulings, and they are colliding, obviously. They both have five men in their chain of narration. But in the first isnad, you have two men from the Sahihain, and in the second hadith, you have three men from the Sahihain. So both hadith are authentic, but we say one is more so than the other. So the more authentic hadith is called Mahfuz, and the less authentic hadith is called Shadh. So we take the Mahfuz and leave off the Shadh. So we say that the Rajih is the Mahfuz hadith.
And then the eighth method
is if we have two narrations and they are colliding, we give precedence to the narration of the person who is pertaining to the story. And we gave an example where Ibn Abbas narrates that the Prophet married Maymuna in the Ihram, but Maymuna herself narrates that he married her when he was halal. So which narration do we give precedence to? Of course the one of Maymuna, because after all it is her he is marrying, so she should know better than Ibn Abbas. Some ulama have given precedence to the statement of Abdullah ibn Abbas because his statement is found in the Sahihain, whereas the statement of Maymuna is in Sahih Muslim. So they say the statement of Ibn Abbas is more authentic, and they say that this is one of the specific aspects of the Prophet that he is allowed to marry in the Ihram and no one else. However, this does not seem to be the correct opinion, because if it wasn't for the statement of Maymuna, then we would say yes, this has to be one of the specific aspects of the Prophet that he is allowed to marry in the Ihram. However, the statement of Maymuna prevents this ruling, because no doubt, as long as the statement of Maymuna is authentic, then we have to accept it, and she should know better than Abdullah ibn Abbas. Then the next method of At-Tarjih, and this is pertaining to the Ijma', and we talked about the Ijma', which is Qat'i, and the Ijma', which is Dhanni. The Qat'i Ijma' is known by necessity in the Sharia, like the Salah being wajib. As for the Ijma', which is Dhanni, then this is when a trustworthy scholar reports that there is an Ijma'. So now we are not 100% sure there is an Ijma', because it might be that this scholar who is reporting the Ijma' may have missed some scholars who hold differing views. So we can say we are not 100% sure, but rather we are more than 50% sure that this is an Ijma'. But the point is, if there is a collision between an Ijma', which is Qat'i, and an Ijma', which is Dhanni, then we give precedence to the Qat'i, to the one which we are 100% certain of. And the final point is pertaining to Al-Qiyas. We talked about Al-Qiyas Al-Jali and Al-Qiyas Al-Khafi. The Qiyas which is Jali, then its Illah is known through the text of the Hadith or Qur'an itself, or from the Ijma', or because we know that there is absolutely no difference between the Asl and the Far'. And as for the Al-Qiyas which is Al-Khafi, the hidden Qiyas, and not the plain or open Qiyas, then this is something which the scholars make ijtihad and extract the illah. So if these two types of Qiyas collide with each other, then we give precedence to the Al-Qiyas Al-Jali over and above the Al-Qiyas Al-Khafi. And the reason for this should be clear, because the illah for the Jali we can be sure of. As for the illah with the Al-Qiyas Al-Khafi, for example with the riba, then this is an illah in which there is some element of doubt. And indeed there is also difference of opinion as to what the illah is, which even adds to the doubt as to what the illah really is. So these were some of the routes or methodologies to make at-tarjih. Just to sum them up, an nas given priority over zahir, ظاهر over المؤول, منطوق over مفهوم, the مثبت over نافي, which is that which makes an affirmation given precedence over that which negates. Then after that we said the evidence which takes you away from the أصل given precedence over the evidence which keeps you on the أصل, because there is extra knowledge in the one which takes you away from the أصل. Then afterwards we said the عام which is stronger given precedence over the عام, the generality which is weaker. Then we said the محفوظ حديث given precedence over the شاذ. Then after that we said the statement of the person to whom the narration is pertaining given precedence over the statement of the person to whom the narration is not pertaining to. Then we said الإجماع القطعي given precedence over الإجماع الظني. And then finally we said القياس الجلي given precedence over القياس الخفي. Now let's move to the next chapter, which is pertaining to the Mufti and the Mustafti. And this chapter has everything to do with Usul al-Fiqh, because you cannot be a Mufti unless you are well versed in the study of Usul al-Fiqh. Because a Mufti needs to have not only knowledge, but this ability to extract rulings from the text and apply them to real life situations. A Mufti is a person who gives you a Shari'i ruling. So it's not just any ruling, but it needs to be one pertaining to the Sharia. So he is the one who gives a fatwa or a futya, which is a Shari'i ruling. As for the Mustafti, then he is the person who is asking for a hukum Shari'i. So now we have a question: what is the difference between a Mufti and a Qadi? Qadi translated to judge. There are two differences, and because of these two differences, the Qadi is far more powerful and of a higher status than a Mufti. First of all, with a Qadi, this is a person who works in a Sharia court. So two disputants come and they need to resolve the issue, and a Qadi gives a decision based on the Quran and the Sunnah, so he also gives a hukum Shari'i. But in this case, he is deciding between two or more disputants. Whereas with a Mufti, this is not necessarily the case. And the second difference is that the decision or the hukum Shari'i which the Qadi gives must be implemented, and you are not allowed to go against it, because it is enforced by the Sharia state. Hence, after the Qadi gives a decision, there can be no arguments. And this is not the case with a Mufti, because a Mufti can simply give a fatwa, but that doesn't mean that anyone else has to agree with it, or indeed has to implement this fatwa in his life. Whereas with a Qadi, it makes no difference whether you like the fatwa he gives or you don't like it, you have to go by it and implement it, because it is enforced by the Sharia state. Hence, the Qadi is in a more powerful position than the Mufti.
Okay, let us take a few review questions. Question number one: how would you resolve an apparent contradiction between two pieces of evidence, each is am and khas at the same time, but from different angles? Explain this using two examples which we gave. Question number two: we mentioned 9 methods of making tarjih. Now, the number of methods of making tarjih is more than 9, but we mentioned 9. Recall all of them, giving any appropriate examples to illustrate the point. And question number three: what is the difference between a Mufti and a Qadi?